days have passed like this. The city, the crowd is fading, moving on. I sometimes have wondered where you've gone. Story carries on. What is up, y'all? What is good, y'all? It's Molly. So in the building, man. In the building, y'all. I apologize for not being the yell. Right now, people are still sleeping. It's like 6, 7 a.m. in the morning right now, so people are still kind of sleeping, but going for my little run, for my little jog, going for my little meditation, do a little bit of yoga, you know what I'm saying? But, you know me, I'm always thinking, always the overthinker, always thinking about everything and anything in life, right? Always thinking about what's affecting me or what's the next move for me, or just life in general. Life is just so magical sometimes, no? Like, I feel like the fact that I'm alive here, the fact that I'm here with y'all, to hear the fact that you guys can listen to me and just speak to me is a blessing by itself, you know what I mean? The fact that we can just communicate with each other in a way that's so diverse with social media, right? But, hopefully y'all can hear me. I've got to raise the volume on my video. I might have to do that later. So if y'all can't hear me, let me know. I'm going to try to work on that. Maybe get a mic, you know what I'm saying, so y'all can hear me a little better. But the Great Cosmic Mother, man. This book is actually the gospel. The gospel. And if y'all haven't read this book, it's called The Great Cosmic Mother. It's called, and also the subtitle is Rediscovering the Religion of Earth. You know what I'm saying? So I guess the real religion, the religion before that, we switched over to different patriarchies and different marks of religions, right? Christianity or Buddhism, whatever you want to call it, like, this tumble before all these different things happened, before that change, and the connection we used to have with the earth, and the connection we used to have with the mother, right? The feminine energy. This classic exploration of the goddess through time and throughout the world draws on religious, cultural, and archaeological sources that recreate the goddess religion that is humanity's heritage. So basically, kind of give you a little run on this book so far, because I've only like maybe through the introduction and the first little preface. Haven't really gotten into the chapters so far yet, but I've been listening to a lot of Instagram people that I follow, like YouTubers that I follow, influencers that I follow. That actually put me on a lot of game into this book, so I had to get it myself, and I'm recommending y'all get it too, you know what I'm saying? But this book is so far it's fairly deep. It talks about the story, I believe, Monica Sojo. So I think it's the author here, Monica, but it's also Barbara. So I think, if I remember correctly, Barbara, they worked on this book together, but I think Barbara is the I guess you could say the, how do I say, I guess the more important person within the authored rights. I don't want to say more important, but I think she has a lot of the philosophies, the modalities of understanding, the science, I guess you could say the spirit science behind a lot of these concepts I'd be learning in this book. But I want to talk about this lady's story. I think it's Monica Sojo. She talks about, you know, her life, you know, her life and what she's kind of gone through, you know, living from being homeless, from not having much food to eat, from being malnourished. And this is all in the 1950s, 1960s. And she was just talking about, you know, how hard it was and how difficult it was for her being about a 56-year-old lady in this time. Not, like I said, being homeless, not having food, being malnourished, having to, you know, escape the realities of, you know, the culture that we kind of live by within the Western society, you know. We don't really treat a woman with the same respect that men get, you know what I'm saying? When it's women that got created us all, when it's women that are the creators of life, you know what I'm saying? Without women, there won't be any of us here. It wouldn't be me here, right? And she just talks about how life is like a wheel, you know, that is always turning. And the wheel has many different meanings, or the wheel has so many different meanings, and she talks about that in the book. And I wanna bring it up in a little later in this book right now, or a little later in this video, but she's reminding me how hard it is, you know what I'm saying? And how difficult it can be, you know what I'm saying, as a woman, or just anybody in general, but more specifically to reach happiness, to reach serenity, to reach love, to reach understanding. And I remember I seen us post, you know, a lot of women are more masculine than anything, and that's the reason why men and women can't really actually have a relationship sometimes, you know? But there was one sex before. It used to be just women, right? They were the original sex. They were the original gender. So, if anything, woman is basically, they say, women is creation and destruction at the same time. They are both, you know what I mean? They are powerful. Women are powerful. And I don't ever want to forget how powerful men is. Like, I dealt with some powerful women in my life. I've dealt with some very powerful ladies in my life, and I'm thankful that I've been able to do that, or meet powerful women in my life that have taught me so many different things that I'm so thankful for, you know what I'm saying? But I kind of want to pull a little bit of this book right here real quickly, but so you talk about the wheel again. So the wheel is a vehicle, a mood, or a mode of direction. He talks about riding a bike, 56-year-old lady riding a bike, you know. My bike's wheels are not precisely round, warped rims, badly braked, punctured seasonal broken glass, right? Threaded tires. But it gets the job done, that's what she says, it gets the job done. And she then says the earth too has a wobble. The earth too is a wheel, right? The earth too is not as symmetrical as you might think it could be. You know, it wobbles when it as it turns, right? As it rotates. So life is always gonna be a little bit of wobble, you know what I mean? She's not gonna always be a nice smooth wheel of path, right? It's always gonna be ups and downs, so to speak. She talks about biking 25 to 50 miles, round trip to tails, you know. She talks about going to Norway, traveling to parts of Britain, parts of Europe, parts of England, parts of Iceland, parts of Sweden. She truly traveled the world. She talks about witches and the goddesses and the witch hunts. You know what I mean? Like, and how like that's been such a thing that's kind of stopped women from their natural ability to connect to the earth, their natural ability to connect to the environment. You know what I'm saying? Ouida is also a torture instrument, where witches were bound for punishment. See, like the wheel, right? Again, with the wheel. You know, sometimes we are bound by this wheel, or we're bound by this circumference, this bubble that we're in, and we don't learn to escape it. We don't learn to understand that there might be a crack somewhere, a weak point in that circle. You know what I'm saying? So many different relations I'm here coming up with, right? Talking about, you know, having to live in parked garages, parked cars, had to live in boarded up houses, barrio porches, backyards, garages. You know what I mean? 24-hour restaurants she had to sleep at. Nighttime helicopters where she's worried about, you know, nighttime police raids. You know, worried about sexual threats or, you know, solicitations from people. You know what I mean? It's a really hard time in this world. Talking about 59 cents, 60 cents for fills for coffee, just to kind of keep it alive, keep it going, right? So, and in her bag, she carried 9 pages resume and 20 odd years of feminist and literacy activity, including this just published book. So like Pluto's book, she carried everything with her. She wrote everything with her, you know what I'm saying? But she said that during all these things, she says that this wheel is surreal. This wheel is surreal. Meaning this wheel, this life, this journey, this how do I say? This journey, or this cycle, that's what I'm looking for, this cycle, it's gonna continue turning. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna continue turning. So, a wheel is directions, energy, also a steering device, a will. How do we dare to live? Personal, political, cosmic. This book here is about, she says, it's about her story, not his story, her story. Understanding where she came from, you know what I'm saying? Understand where this creation came from, where God came from, where this light came from, where the goddesses of gods came from, right? Because the earth is a goddess. The earth is a goddess, you know what I'm saying? So, understand how important to understand how Mother Earth and how we have been neglecting it, how we haven't been giving it its right nutrition it needs, you know what I'm saying, to be its best version, to be our best version as well, because we feed on that. We are in its womb. We are its seeds. We are part of it, right? He says that nothing is easy in life. Work we thought done must be redone. Work, let me say this again. Work we thought done must be redone. You know what I'm saying? Often I feel like, you know, we learn something. I feel like even me. I feel like I've learned about spirituality, right? But you can't get too into your spiritual ego. You know, there's always room for growth. There's always room for more understanding. There's always room for, you know, becoming a better version of yourself. And work that we thought was done must be redone. So I must re-educate myself. I must re-educate and learn and gain more information. Right, so she says, I could change God's sex, but it couldn't pay my rent. I could rewrite his story, but it couldn't afford to eat. I survive with a grimmer face. a stronger, more ancient face. Our stubborn struggle too is organic. This wheel is a book she began and again. Man, always kind of be rolling, you know what I'm saying? So, talks about the great mother. The great mother in her, I'm gonna read this from the book straight. The great mother in her many aspects, maiden, raging, warrior, benevolent mother, death-dealing and wise crone, unknowable and ultimate word, is now powerfully re-emerging and rising again in human consciousness as we approach the 21st century. Isis, Mawalisa, Demeter, Gaia, Shakti, Dakinis, Shekinah, Astarte, Ishtar, Rhea, Freya, Nerthus, Bridget, Danu, call her what she may, has been with us from the beginning, awaits us now. She's the beauty of the green earth, the life-giving waters, the consuming fire, the radiant moon, the fiery sun. She is star goddess and spider woman. She leaves the luminous web that is, that creates this universe. As earth, the great planetary spirit being, she germinates life within our dark womb. She then says, I'm gonna skip around. The earth's immune system is breaking down and so is ours. Her soul, her atmosphere, her plant life, her trees, the animal worlds are exhausted and beyond endurance. All beings are suffering and cannot take more. Based on the Western culture, we have now kind of run ourselves to the ground. I'm paraphrasing. If we are to survive, we have to attune yet again to the spirits of nature. And we must learn to hear the voices of the ancestors who speak to us from the other world realms. So if we were to come back to our natural state, so to speak, we must begin to communicate with the earth again. We must begin to communicate with the spirits again, the moons again, the stars again, the sun again. We must communicate with the energies. And that's something I know I've been neglecting. I know there's a full moon coming around, but that's the most I do. I know there's astrology here and there, but I don't fully devote myself into understanding it. You know, they say millionaires don't need astrology, but billionaires do. They said that billionaires know astrology. Billionaires understand the flow of life, the flow of energy, the flow of the earth, like the stars, the moons, the cycles. So that's just something to tell y'all right there, you know what I'm saying? In the Western world, the assault of woman's last remnants of autonomous powers, the destruction of our ancient knowledge of healing and of magical technology that enhanced our psychic powers, as well as the fertility of land, came about with the witch hunts that lasted more than 300 years ago. Let me say that again. So basically, due to the Western world's assaults on woman's ancient knowledge, ancient healings, magical technologies, that enhanced their psychic powers, that enhanced their fertility of the land, you know what I mean? We basically lost that, you know what I'm saying, due to these witch hunts. We lost these abilities. Women lost these abilities due to these witch hunts, you know what I'm saying? There's not many witches. I guess in some ways, true. I wouldn't say there's no such thing as true witches. I'm sure there's a lot of witches out here. I know witch myself. You feel me? But what I would say is that due to the erasement of history, erasement of knowledge, erasement of information, you know, a lot of us has taken a lot of our time, a lot of women's time for us to reemerge as the goddesses that they are. You feel me? Like, Women are so pure and so beautiful. Let me go back into this mortal. So basically, she talks about my political activism always grew out of my spiritual understandings of the earth as a living mother because the goddess is injured. Wherever there is injustice, wanton cruelty, poverty, and pollution. Of course, the goddess is not just beloved, benevolent, and fertile. She's also death-dealing and the destroyer. But these are natural forces, neither good or bad. It is the impersonal universal dance. But what I'm speaking of here is the destruction brought about the selfish and despotic patriarchs, male brotherhoods who hate organic life in itself, and desire to become disembodied, thereby returning to an abstract and impossible father who desires sterile death and no rebirth for us all. I'm just drinking a little soup, you know what I'm saying? Take a little sip. So like I said, you know, a lot of this has changed due to, I'll keep it a stack, you know what I mean? Like, due to males, or certain males. I don't want to say all males, because there are males, and she talked about this as well, that there are times where there was harmony. You know what I'm saying? And men fully truly understood themselves and knew their role, and women knew their roles, vice versa. But I'm talking about the men, the evil men, I'm calling them evil men, who created this brotherhood, that created this this way of life that we have now today, that is so backwards, so inorganic, so unnatural to how we live our lives today. You know what I'm saying? And I'm pleased to say that, it says right here, thereby returns an abstract and impossible father who desires sterile death and with no rebirth for us all. Sterile death and no rebirth for us all. Life is all about rebirth. Life is all about, you know, coming back to life. And if you, I always say to people, you know, if not in this life, but the next. You know what I'm saying? Because I understand that there is something called reincarnation. But How do you reborn? How do you realign yourself to the truth, to your truths, to your energies? You know what I'm saying? She talks about doing a lot of art. She does a lot of art. She loves to draw. She says, I always experience my art as what can only be described as shamanic process. Entering into a state of being of mind where knowledge is available from past, present, and future. This way of knowing belongs to the Lunar Mother, who is both dark and light. So, as she goes through her shamanic processes, right, she understands that within the five dimensions there is past, present, and future. That there is, they're all connected, they're all one. You know what I mean? There is no difference. And when you understand the knowing of life, right? You understand that the Lunar Mother is both dark and light, dark and good. The darkness, she shines light in the dark, right? And she illuminates. But she comes of that energy, ultimately. So, in this book, she also talks about her youngest son passing away. Part Afro-American, part Swedish. Killed in the eyes in the Basque country in south of France. But her oldest son as well dying of lymphoma cancer in July of 1987. She then states that's when her new journey began. That's when her new time began, when she lost. When she lost, that's when she went out and embarked into a new journey to find more about herself. You know? Truly a darkness of my soul, during which I didn't want to live and at times hated everything alive. I have come through this still loving this beautiful earth, our mother. I have now returned the paintings and writing the expeditions I'm traveling. It gave me hope to watch and courage, and it gave me hope to watch the courage and loving energy my oldest son radiated before his death. In spite of his pains and illness, my sons communicate with me in my dreams. And I've been doing a lot of dream work a lot lately myself. Shit, this is gonna be a little crazy. She talks about. I truly knew that the earth is her living body. I also felt her grief and her pain, her great love and rage. So the earth is living, right? The earth is a living body. And we haven't been taking care of it, so to speak. You know, this world that we're living right now, especially right now, is a place that isn't in the best, how do I say, state. You know, we live like right now, but everything's going on with the world, with politics, with wars, with how we treat each other, how we treat one another. You know, there's a dissonance. You know what I mean? Like there, like I'm sure y'all can feel it. I'm sure y'all that around here right now have been feeling it. The world isn't the same. The world is definitely changing. The world definitely has a lot of pain right now. And I think that's why we are also affected by it. We're also affected by this earth that we live right now. And subconsciously, or whether conscious or not, it affects us. So, that's all I want to kind of talk about right now. I'm going to kind of leave it at that for the most part. But something that that inspired me is that when she said that she lost her sons, and that's when her life changed, her path changed. You know, sometimes when you lose things, or you lose, I don't know, people in your life, whether it be a parent, a grandparent, a mother, a father, a brother, a sister, partner, etc. Even a pet, you know what I mean? Like, those things or these times when you lose things, or sometimes that helps create the stepping stones for new lives, for new opportunities, for new understandings of yourselves. You know what I mean? So, as I'm kind of going through my own journey and I'm understanding my life right now, I understand that losing things is not necessarily a bad thing, because you never really lose things. As you said, I see my sons in my dreams. That energy is still within you. It lives within yourself. It's what you do with that energy. It's what you do with that. But those memories, those feelings, those emotions, how do you let them travel into something else? How do you transmute that into a new being, a new light, a new journey? But anyways, I hope you have a great day. I hope you're feeling well. I know this might have been a longer video than usual, but I really just wanted to like express to y'all how much I am enjoying this book, and hope y'all can gain some knowledge too. But peace and love to the gods, peace and love to the gang. You know what I'm saying? I love y'all, I appreciate y'all. I fuck with y'all. Let's get it. Ah.